Big Mike here with
He's Entertainment.
Today's episode, we got Vancouver Canucks, Sven Baertschi.
If you like what we're doing, hit the subscribe button. Let's go.
Hey, I'm Sven Baertschi. I'm coming up on the I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
Looking for the most beers on tap, great steaks, great staff? Head over to the John B. Pub.
We got the best beers, steaks, chicken wings, nachos in town. Come see us at the John B. Pub.
The John B. Pub, the best bar in town. Come sign up for our football pool. Say hey, St. You.
The number one sports podcast in Vancouver with Ryan Hayes and Big Mike.
Ryan Hayes and Big Mike. I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
And Hall gets the second assist. Here's Baertschi with a shot. He scores. Sven Baertschi picked up at the deadline in a deal with Calgary with a big smile. Baertschi, nice move. Shoots. He scores. Has the puck. Long pass ahead, a good one. And here's Baertschi alone. Deep, he scores. Sven Baertschi on the Hail Mary pass from Alex Edler. And the Canucks have tied the game in one.
That'd be like a 40-yard bomb in football. From his own goal line almost, but Baertschi with an even better play to pick it up.
This is I Only Touch Greatness podcast with Ryan Hayes.
Good, how
Mike.
Good, how are you? Good, thank you. Thank you for taking the time to talk to us today.
Oh, yeah. Might as well.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I don't know. I'll get to that in a sec. I'm Ryan, by the way, and this is Big Mike.
Hey, Sven. Right. Thank you very much for taking the time for us.
Sweet hat, bud.
Thank you.
Hey, both of them are good. I like Mike's hat today. He doesn't really wear that one very often. Yeah. I don't know. What I was going to say there was, I don't know if we ever ran into each other before through some of the alumni events. Or I was also the Don Cherry guy that dresses up as Don Cherry and went to the
Cubs. Oh, God. Maybe. Yeah. Who knows? I mean, yeah,
pretty sure I ran into you somewhere. I can't remember which one of the events, but
yeah.
That's true. How are you holding up?
Good, good. Finally playing again. So.
Yeah.
Getting some games in and stuff, and so sort of back to how it's supposed to be.
Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah, I saw you scored. I think it was last night or the night before.
Yeah. No, it's been good. We had a rough patch there where a bunch of our guys got sick and we didn't play a game for a whole month. And then so it got rolling. It sort of gets you back into like a rhythm. Like I said, how it's supposed to be. And so we're able to string some games together, pretty much play every other day now. And I think there's 6 or 7 games left now. So trying to make the most of it.
Exactly. Exactly. So born and raised in Switzerland, what was childhood like for you growing up?
Fairly simple. I grew up in a small town. I think it was around 4,000 people.
Wow.
School. I rode my bike to hockey. So small town, but hockey was really popular. It was one of those things around Switzerland. I think soccer, hockey, obviously tennis with Roger Federer. And then you got the skiing and stuff in the winter, hockey as well. So it was one of those sports where my dad played professionally, and so it was sort of automatic. Me and my brother, both of us started playing. He was a goalie, I was always a forward, and then it just grew up there, played in the same organization all the way as a kid, all the way up to junior level, and then there you have the men's team as well in the same organization, so it's all together. Made the jump to the men's team which was in the second league in Switzerland. Made a jump there when I was 16, I believe. And then came over to Portland for 2 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, that led to the next question was drafted by Portland Winterhawks. What was your time like there? And it must have been a little bit of a culture shock as well.
Yeah. And it was my first time ever on the plane. When we traveled as kids, like, you know, you're in Europe, like everything is nearby. Went to a bunch of different countries, but I never really had to fly. You just take a bus or you drive. So that was my first flight, which was you got probably an hour and a half to Amsterdam and all the way straight to Portland. So that was, I was miserable on the plane because it just wasn't used to that kind of travel. And then obviously arrived, and then I remember it was, Travis actually came to pick me up at the airport, and I was just shocked by, how big everything is and just the highways and everything. It just blew me away. And I didn't speak any English too. So back then in school, I thought it was because English is optional or was optional. I don't know what it's like now, but I thought it was useless. And sure enough, I realized that I probably should have stayed an extra hour in school and learned some English because I didn't understand a single word when I got there and I was all confused.
Oh, really? I didn't know that. That's crazy. That's hard to communicate with your line mates too and your teammates.
Terrible. Terrible, but when I got there nicely enough, I think it was Ryan Johansson and Nino was there too. So Nino was able to help me out a bit. And I remember it was one of the first nights they came to pick me up and went bowling together. So I got to know a few of the, because when you get there, like it's still camp, right? And like there's so many kids. I think there was like 60 kids there. And I thought like going into camp there was just going to be the team. And it wasn't like that. And there's all these kids there. I remember, and I got to training camp and I went into a locker room. I sat down, put my stuff down, and I shook everybody's hand because I thought it'd be nice, right? But then I realized there's way too many guys. So I think they just looked at me as like, what's wrong with this guy? Because I thought I just met like all my new teammates for the season.
Yeah.
But really, it was tryouts and it was a camp and I didn't really realize that. I think Mike sort of looked at me, he's like, what's going on with this guy? And so it was a bit of an adjustment there, but it took me a little while to get used to the small ice and everything and get used to the type of hockey we're playing over here. And so it took me a little while to get going. I think it was the second or third preseason game where I really got going and scored 4 goals and I felt good about my game. And then I sort of took off from there and had two pretty good seasons there in Portland.
I was going to say, you went on a tear in Portland and then being selected 13th overall by the Calgary Flames. Take me back to draft day.
Yeah, it was wild. That was absolutely, it was a cool experience. Bringing my family, traveling to Minnesota at the time. Just going there, just experiencing everything combined together with the combine before. It's just a completely new world for a kid from Switzerland, from a small town. You know, you meet all these important people from over here, and all of a sudden, like it sort of kicks in, and it could be reality that you're selected in the draft. And as a kid growing up in Switzerland, you sort of, those are just dreams. You know, like it's for me, it was always just a dream, and then once I came over, I sort of realized that it can become a goal. And then going to the draft, it was just, it really kicked in. It's like some team actually might want me here and it actually could be in the first round. So that was an awesome experience. And then obviously your name being called there and just the audience and it's just all around, it's just an unbelievable experience.
Did you know the Flames were interested in you? Like, had they been talking to you?
So the meeting with the Flames that I had at the combine, because a lot of times they're all like super, it's really serious, right? You walk in and you're nervous as hell and you're sweating and like they ask you all these difficult questions. And Calgary was one of those things where I remember I walked in and I think it was Ron Sutter at the time. He asked me if I wanted some cookies. or something, and pretty much told me to lay down on the couch and just relax for a bit, and then asked me a few questions. It was pretty, it was a super simple interview, and what I did, I was just being honest, really, at the combine, and they were honest with me, and it was just, yeah, it was one of those things where I think it was Carolina had the pick before, and it was a defenseman, maybe it was Murphy or somebody, that wasn't picked earlier. It was supposed to go super early, and Carolina picked him. And then I think Calgary's table was near us. So my agent sort of looked down, and at the time, I believe it was, yeah, it was John Weiss. He sort of gave my agent like the thumbs up. And my agent looked at me, he's like, they're gonna pick you. And then I was like, start freaking out. I'm like, no, that was just crazy. And sure enough, they picked me. I was up there, Jay Feaster, Craig Conroy is up there as well. So it was awesome. It was a cool experience.
Mike?
Yeah. Do you remember your first goal, and do you still have the puck?
I do have the puck. It's at my mom's place, Switzerland. I do remember that because I got called up by the juniors. So it was an emergency call up. And I was supposed to play a game in Kamloops, and then got a call at like 7 a.m. It was game day, and it was Mike Johnson, and he told me to come to the rink, and I was nervous. I was like, I don't know, did they trade me or something, right? And because I was at the first training camp with Calgary there, and they sent me back. So there's some work you need to, you know, do to get ready, come ready next camp, and you get your chance. And so I never thought throughout, see, I didn't even know it was possible that they could just bring you up at a junior. But at the time they had, you know, hurt guys. And so Mike told me, like, they called you up and you're going to play your first NHL game tomorrow. They're having a lot of injuries there, so they need you. And it was the first game back against the Winnipeg Jets when they first came back in the league. So it was absolute amazing atmosphere. And I thought I was just there for one game. And then Brent Sutter, after the game, was like, you got to travel with us tomorrow. We're going to go to Minnesota and play there. So I went to Minnesota, and then I scored my first goal in Mini. And it was pretty cool. It was just a shot from the point, deflection, and then I got the rebound. And the coolest thing was that after the rebound came to me, everything was in slow motion because I had a wide open net to shoot at. And I looked down, and like the NHL logo space was up. And I remember I'm staring at the puck. I'm like, all you got to do is it was literally slow motion. I was like, just put it in and you got it. And then I scored, and it was a cool experience.
Just like Happy Gilmore, just tap it in.
Exactly. Yeah. So it's one of those things you're just never going to forget ever.
Yeah.
So I decided to keep it at my mom's place, and that's home, and whenever I come home, then I, you know, can look at it and go through those memories again.
So the Canucks just got Abbotsford as the new farm team, like where Utica would be moving to. What was your time with the Heat when you were in Abbotsford?
A little bit different, you know, because while I was there, you know, it was a lockout year, and then there was no teams in the West, right? So our travel was pretty wild. So we had the teams in Texas. I think at the time there was three teams in Texas. So either we'd go to Texas or fly to Chicago for away games and then go from there wherever we needed to. So the team that year, I was gone after, you know, halfway through when we started up in the NHL. But I think the team spent like 90 days on the road that year.
Wow.
And, well, that was tough for everybody. You know, it's like the night before you got to travel to Vancouver and then fly to Chicago. And then, you know, it's a full day and you go the night before. And so it was pretty wild, but we had a great team there. Still enjoyed it. The only problem is obviously you got Calgary's team in BC.
Yeah, in the Vancouver market.
Yeah, which didn't bring in a big audience. And at the time, Chicago Bulls were Vancouver's team. So whenever they came to town, it was rocking. The arena was filled and they were cheering against us, even though we're the home team. So a little bit different, but Yeah, it was still good. And it was, you know, my first pro, like, away from the games the season before. It was my first pro experience going through that whole process. So I really enjoyed it.
And now they, at least now the division that Utica's going into, they got the Sons of Anarchy division, where it's like the Stockton, the Oakland, you know, all those California teams on the West Coast. You're not traveling all the way to Texas.
Yeah. And I think, you know, for Vancouver anyways, I think it's a smart idea to have the team there, especially with call-ups and things. It's going to make a lot of things easier. I mean, you know, I've spent time at Adirondack and stuff, and I was getting called up from the Flames at the time. And it might be after a game, and you literally get in, a driver comes, picks you up. You drive 4 hours, and you fly out of Montreal. And, you know, you get there early in the morning, get a couple hours of sleep, you fly all the way across the country pretty much. And then sometimes you play that same night, which has happened before. And
that's guys
getting called up here out of Utica, like that's a hike, you know, go over to Vancouver and play, you know? And so if they need you quick, then I think it's much easier for them to have a team in Abbotsford.
And take us back to your first time being traded. Why'd you ask to leave Calgary?
Different reasons. I think one of the reasons that was sort of well known is that me and the head coach at the time, it just didn't really see eye to eye, and
I honestly didn't even know that
we didn't get along really well, and I struggled with him a lot of times, and just had a really rough go there with him, and didn't make things easier for me, and I, you know, tried everything I could. And then I was going into a season, I was up and down, I don't know how many times, maybe 6-7 times, just going back and forth, trying again, and then, you know, being sent down again. And I remember having a talk with my agent, and, you know, he contacted a team, and we sort of tried to figure out a solution for what's best for me. And, you know, at the time, Brad for Living was helping me out there, try to find a new place for me to play and sort of restart, you know, have a fresh start. And that's how it really worked out. You know, I also had great times in Calgary, and but also battled lots of adversity, but learned a lot as well. But then I was able to move on, and, you know, they sent me to Vancouver where I had, you know, good success.
Yeah.
You absolutely. We love you here in Vancouver. Trust me. who did you mirror your game after, or try and play like when you were growing up?
Oh, it's hard to say. I always enjoyed watching a lot of the Russian players for skill, you know, Ilya Kovalchuk, Alexei Kovalev. But for me, it's always, I try to snag different things from different players to learn. I wouldn't say I had just one guy where I was like, maybe Malkin in some ways, but the problem is I'm not as tall as him.
Yeah.
Hard to mirror that, but I try to snag whatever I could, you know, from the best players throughout the league. And I always admired the skill that Russian players have, the skating ability from the Swedish guys, like a sort of, you know, found that really helpful to help my game.
That's for sure. And Pavel Bure is my favorite player.
So yeah.
There's one that could skate and had the Russian play too.
Yeah. We had just a great combination of skill and speed. And that was fun to watch. And it was fun to play with on the PlayStation too.
Yeah, exactly.
NHL 94. That was the best.
It just flew by. There's no problem.
Hey, you know what Canuck fans do after they win the Stanley Cup? Turn off the PlayStation. and that hurts me to say that. If you could sit down for dinner with anyone dead or alive, who would it be?
Oh, good question. First thing that comes to mind is Roger Federer. He, you know, growing up in Switzerland, the success he's had, the impact he's had on the world, really, you know, he's one of those guys where he just, because I was able to see pretty much his whole career growing up. And I remember when, you know, like when he played, the TVs were on everywhere. Like everybody's watching. My mom at times, you know, depending where the tournament was, TV was on early in the morning watching him. And just seeing who he has become, you know, like he's such an important figure in Switzerland. And he's, you know, sports wise overall, I think he's just really my idol, you know, when it comes to overall sport, how he is as a person. And I've never got to see him play, which is still a hope I can somehow do it, you know, before he finishes. But I think he'd be one of those guys where I just want to sit down and sort of pick his brain and figure out who he is, you know.
That's a good choice.
And who would you say was the second most famous Swiss would be?
Second most famous Swiss person?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
You're putting him on the spot.
Yeah, besides yourself, then.
No, you are putting me on the spot. Oh. That's tough.
Okay.
Okay, we'll go to the next one. What's that?
Next question.
Yeah. No problem. I know how you were just talking about learning from Swedish players, and you got to play with two of the best here in Vancouver. How much did you learn from them, and how fun was it to play with them?
It was spectacular. Learned a lot hockey-wise, but almost learned more away from the ice. These two guys are the most spectacular guys I've ever met. Just the nicest people, the most generous people, and hardest working guys as well. You just couldn't beat them in the gym. They always found another gear somehow. Just didn't matter. Like, cause there's one summer I trained in Vancouver all summer pretty much. And we would be in the gym together, and we have those different bike rides throughout the week. And like we would post numbers, they would post a better one. We'd post a better one, they would post a better one. And then we had always had ping pong matches after, and at times they would last a few hours. We'd just be at the rink for a few more hours just playing because they got beat and they want to beat you 10 times after that. super competitive. Them two together combined, probably best teammates ever had. And just the on-ice stuff. I mean, it's hard to do the stuff they do on the ice together. It just, you know, I almost need another me out there. But just the way they play, the way they understood the game, the way they saw things out there on the ice. You know, just the little details that you pick up throughout practice and then you pick it up throughout the game sort of helped me develop certain skills that a normal person really wouldn't think of. Like Hank, both of them together were probably the best guys in the league picking pucks off the wall. Like, you know, they rim it back and forth. And still, there's times where the puck comes in and it kind of bobbles over my stick. But like for Hank, it would just be the easiest thing ever. Like it would be the hardest rim ever. And he would, boom, like it's on his forehand. He's making a play. And the details that you see is like, how do you like, is it repetition? Is it just a certain feel that you have? And I would ask them all these questions. And that's sort of how I learned more things to add to my repertoire out there.
And we know firsthand how nice they can be. They've been great to me and Mike before, every time we've met them at all the Canuck events. Do you have a favorite sports movie?
Sports movie. I gotta say, I think I gotta say Happy Gilmore, I guess.
Awesome. Yeah, good choice.
I don't think it gets much better than that, really. Especially like you sort of seeing him beating the crap out of guys on the golf course. And but it's just kind of, it's one of those movies you can watch
over. So
it's just still fun, you know.
Do you have a favorite comedian while we're on that topic or actor?
Comedian. Lately, I've been watching some Bill Burr, which is hilarious. Ricky Gervais.
Yeah.
Kevin Hart. Those are my go-to guys. Actors, not so much. I'm not really that into these different actors. I do love comedians, stand-up comedians that are, I enjoy watching it, and it, you know, keeps you sort of, it keeps me loose before games too. Like now we get the daily bus trips and we bus on the same day that we play, and sort of keeps me loose before a game.
Yeah. Yeah. How important is a player's public image?
I think it's really important. And I think one of those, to me, hockey players, I think are phenomenal when it comes to that. You know, there's not much drama at times throughout each season. I think hockey players are, in general, really generous guys and sort of have the right attitude as well. So it is important, but I think it's also a thing, the way you're raised, it never really changes. You know, if you have a hockey locker room, is, to me, it's just a bunch of brothers and we're all like to have fun, and it sort of shows that as well on the outside.
And I always think of like the Evander Kane picture where he's sitting there holding the money, and that's what comes to mind. That's why we write that question, is I think of that every time I ask that question.
I mean there's, you can build your brand as well, right? It's one of those things. I'm not really huge on social media or, you know, I don't know. I'm just not really into that kind of stuff, to be honest with you.
Mike, you got one?
Yeah, what's your favorite road barn or favorite road city?
In the AHL?
Or NHL.
Or NHL, or both. Actually, both.
NHL, I always enjoyed playing in Chicago. Great city, great atmosphere in the arena. And then Vegas came into the league, and going up for warmups, it's like a nightclub. the music, like it feel like the whole arena is just shaking. So once they came in the league, I thought that was pretty cool, and I enjoyed playing there. I always loved going back to Minnesota, playing there. Great atmosphere as well, and it always reminds me of my first goal when I go there. AHL is a little tougher. A lot of smaller barns, but we played a game in Cleveland last season, and they're having a really, really, I think they must have had like 15,000 people probably.
Oh wow.
A day, something like that. I might be lying, but it was packed. It was a great atmosphere, and it felt like an NHL game.
That's awesome.
Yeah, in Cleveland's one city, I never even think of hockey. Do they have like much team? They must have an AHL team, obviously.
But yeah, the Cleveland Monsters.
Yeah. So they, at times they were saying that they actually get more fans than that. But the Cavaliers.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So they got a good atmosphere there.
Hey, are we allowed to ask you any questions about the Canucks?
Yeah, sure. Sure. Okay.
Depends. Yeah, and just say next question if you don't want. They're not too bad around here. When you signed the 3-year deal for $10 million, do you regret that at all after seeing our salary cap issue nowadays that's kind of almost forced you out?
Great question. in some ways, yes. In other ways, no. Because why?
That money.
Yeah. So obviously, I guess the main issue there was the one season where I didn't play many games. But other than that, you know, the years before, you know, we didn't have a really strong team, and I was performing on a good level, I think. And then up until that injury, like I was off to a really good start to that year there, and I was scoring, and I thought I was going to have a career season, and then, you know, it got hurt, and then I missed a big chunk of the season. and going into next camp, maybe in some ways people's opinion sort of changed on my game. It's possible. But I was also coming into a training camp where I played 26 games the year before. So maybe it took me a little while to get going and didn't really have the luxury maybe to, I mean, I thought I, you know, played pretty good throughout the preseason. But again, maybe it hurt me that I didn't play as many games the year before. And then, you know, ended up being sent down. And I was hoping that at some point they're going to bring me up and let me play regularly again. And that just wasn't the case. So then it becomes a thing where I just decided to keep working on my game no matter what. And then obviously ended up being, might have been some issues money-wise. You know, yeah. the team wasn't able to, you know, get me up there. And then this offseason again, you know, not having any space for me. But again, I signed a contract based on the way I performed the previous year, and that's how it works. And
yeah, it's not like it's your problem. That's Benning's problem. Yeah.
Right. So then it becomes a thing. I've earned that money, and we signed a contract, and, you know, I just kept working on my game. And yes, I'm still here in Utica, but I'm also becoming a free agent this offseason.
Yeah, and you're going to have a great rest of your career for sure, because us, as me and Ryan, like, we're huge fans of you, and we always were, and we'd love to see you back with the Canucks, but clearly they have no interest, so it's kind of shitty on our part.
It's also because of the cap issue as well. It's not, maybe not that they don't have interest, it's the fact that they can't afford to bring you up.
Yeah. So in that way, it's sort of, yes, did it hurt me? Probably, when it comes to, you know, the cap. But yeah, so, I mean.
We only have like three questions about current Canucks stuff.
The thing too is, like, I know, like, you two guys as well, like, there's lots of love for me in Vancouver.
Yeah, there is.
I've always appreciated that. And that sort of is one of those things that keeps you going as a player. You know, when you know that there's love, and, you know, I get tweets and stuff, people still cheering for me, even though I'm not even playing in Vancouver. So that's always a great boost for the morale.
So you also had two coaches while you were here, with Willie D and Green. Was there one lesson that each of them taught you that you liked, or was there one you liked better than the other? Not that you can say much on that, probably.
Well, so Greener and I, we go back, you know, so we have quite a relationship together. And, you know, Willie was a great coach. He was a great mind. You know, our team just wasn't quite built to, you know, go in the playoffs. And that's just the way it was there. So he was in a tougher spot. But, you know, both coaches taught me important lessons. One of the things Willie always told me is to watch Hank and Danny on a daily basis to learn.
Good advice.
Yeah. And really, that's what it was all about for him, is to watch the veteran guys perform, practice off ice and stuff. And that's why I ended up spending pretty much a whole summer in Vancouver, because guys like Chris Higgins were there. Hank and Danny were in the gym pretty much every day. And so that gave me an opportunity to learn from them as well. And then with Travis, yeah, like I said, you know, we go back 2 years in junior, finals twice. When I got traded first, played here, final.
Yeah.
So we had quite the success together.
Mike?
Yeah. One guy I'm a huge fan of in Utica right now that you're playing with is Jonah Gajewicz. Can you give us a good story about him?
He's just, this year we became, I think, really, like, he's always been a quiet guy, sort of, around the rink. And this year, yeah, sort of got him a little warmed up a bit and became better and better friends throughout this year. I'm sort of sad he's gone, but he's, he's definitely earned it. Like he's just become an absolute beast around the net. And that's where he's been scoring. Like it's just been amazing. Like to see him find success early on in the season around the net and then just sticking with it. And he was able to just perform so well around the net. Like it's crazy. Like I've never seen it before. Like everything.
I hope the Canucks give him a shot here.
I hope so too. He's definitely earned it. Like he's the way I see it, like this year, I think he again took a massive stride, even though it's been absolute weird season, but I think he's really put in work throughout the summer into fall. And then when he came in the camp and stuff here, like I thought he took a massive step, and it's been fun watching him play. And he's been huge on a power play. You know, he's not the guy that's just going to carry the puck everywhere. He's more the guy that's going to give you time and space out there if you play with him. Like, he plays really aggressive, fast, and just is a little bulldozer on the ice. You know, it's just anything that comes in the way. And the last few games he's played, he beat the crap out of some guys. Like,
he sticks up for his teammates too, that's for sure.
And he was laughing at that guy's face before the fight even started, and he beat the crap out of him. And I was like, all right, this guy's for real, you know, like he doesn't mess around. So he keeps adding things to his game I hope for him that he can become a regular NHL guy.
So who in Utica or the Canucks would you say you're the closest with?
Us Europeans always sort of stick together, you know. Like me and Jazzy get along really well. Obviously trying to be good friends, like, you know, obviously this year with St. Louis coming in and us being split, it was kind of awkward for like a week, and then we all of a sudden became all great friends. And I didn't, like, you don't even notice anymore that we're two separate teams. But yeah, Jazzy, a lot of similarities to, you know, where we grew up and stuff, and which is sort of similar personality and stuff. And we got along really well. Same humor too.
And you, were you not at Bo's? I think you were at Bo's wedding, right?
I was in Bo's wedding.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. That's who I thought you were going to say. I thought you were going to say Bo on that one.
I didn't know. I thought we were talking about the team here. Okay. No, with Bo, me and Bo, yeah, we're great buddies. And, you know, keep in touch as much as we can here. I know he's busy, I'm busy, but we're just a little dude. And, but yeah, I was able to be in his wedding and I had a great time. And, yeah, it was a cool experience.
And are you really looking forward to finally getting another shot at the NHL here?
Yeah, I mean, I really hope I get to. I think I have a lot to give. I know I'm turning 29 next October, but we got so much to give. You know, obviously one of the things is it doesn't really look great, you know, if you spent 2 years in the AHL, but the way I look at it, I'm an NHL player playing in the AHL.
Yeah.
And so that's sort of my mindset. And I feel like that's where my game is at. There's times where I notice it in games, where guys maybe don't quite think the same way I do. And that's just confirmation for me that, hey, you don't really belong here. You think differently. You're a little ahead of what the thought process of let's say an AHL player is. And so that's just confirmation. And I sure hope that going into this off season, first time being a UFA, I hope there's a team out there that's willing to give me a shot, and then I can restart my career and get after it again.
Yeah, and that's for sure. And in your defense, I honestly think it's got a lot to do with the contracts, just and poor management by the GM. But that's my opinion, not yours. What do you think the biggest challenges an athlete faces on a daily basis?
On a daily basis,
honestly?
I think it's, you know, let's say in a normal season, you know, you go through those 82 games, or I don't know, it's like 70 something here in the AHL. I think it's being consistent. I think is one of the hardest things to do in our sport, because it's such a physical sport, and every other night you got to perform at your highest level, or else it's just going to stick out like a sore thumb. And, you know, I think that's one of those things where I think it's something you learn over time, is to go into a season, and instead of a roller coaster season of emotions, you sort of try to keep that steady. Like, I'm reading this book right now, and it's about Russell Wilson and how his thought process is
ahead of the time.
It's staying neutral.
Okay. Right?
It's being in that neutral state, no matter what the time is in the game, no matter, you know, if it's a Super Bowl or a regular season game, and letting sort of your preparation, all that, take care of itself, and emotionally staying at that neutral state, even though it might be the biggest play of the year, it's still just a play, and he knows how to make it play. And sort of, I just started the book, but it's really interesting. And I think that was one of the things where I had great success in Vancouver, is never get too high and never get too low. And sort of that helped me be consistent in my game. It's, you know, if I score two goals in a game, yes, I'm excited, I'm really excited. But then as I go to bed, I'm like, okay, I got to perform again tomorrow to put that away. Or the same thing if I had a terrible game and had a bunch of turnovers or whatever. Put it aside. Tomorrow's a new day, new challenges, and stay in that neutral state. And that's where I had my good success.
And obviously, I'm a huge Russell Wilson fan, being a Seahawks supporter, yeah. As you can see.
That guy's an absolute beast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I obviously, you know, living in Portland, Seattle is one of the teams too, and you know, playing in Vancouver, I think Seattle is sort of the home team.
Yeah,
and they're watching there. Yeah.
You go down and watch some Seahawks games when you were here?
I ended up, there was a couple of years in Vancouver throughout the preseason. I watched, I think, two preseason games. But obviously having the summer off, once in a while I head to Seattle and watch some Mariners game. But I got to watch a couple of preseason game, which I didn't, but the atmosphere, like, it doesn't even feel like a preseason
game. No, it doesn't. Yeah, like, we've been to a few of those preseason games for sure.
So cool.
Especially when we went to an Oakland preseason game a couple seasons ago, and they traveled all the way up here, all their fans, and they just packed the building. It was nuts.
Yeah.
Do you have a dream foursome of golf?
Ooh. That's a good one. Tiger, of course. I think anybody would say
that. Yeah.
Jack Nicklaus in his prime. If I could time travel.
I like it. I like it.
I mean, he's the GOAT. Bryson right now, just to see him pipe a few off the tee.
Yeah.
And then I think Jordan Spieth. I picked him in my pool when we had the Masters pool. And he was a horse. I thought he was going to do it. And he's playing really well, actually. So I'm glad he's back playing well.
Yeah, he's back playing well, that's for sure. Who's the best Canuck golfer? Who's the best golfer when you were out here playing?
Oh, I played quite a few rounds. I definitely can't say Bo. He's decent, but he's also freaking just rips it as hard as he can. There's a few guys. One of the best ones I ever played with was Carter Banks.
Oh, really? Okay.
Camp and stuff in Vancouver, and but he was also here. Remember played a few rounds with him, like way back though. That was before when we were in Calgary. So he was unreal. Like he's scratch for sure.
Wow,
so he was really good. Marky was fun to play with because everything was a stinger. Everything, like off the tee, like it just stingers all day. It was one of those that goes and then it starts climbing and then it just drops down. He would just smash, like you think the ball would explode, he just smashes it. And so he was always fun playing with.
Yeah, do you have many hobbies outside of hockey?
Yeah, obviously golf. Yep. Golf is one of the things.
Sounds like it.
I enjoy fishing. Try to get out a few times throughout the summertime, go to the Oregon coast, fish out there. And then obviously now it's, you know, we got a 2-year-old. So my hobby is just to watch him enjoy each day and you sort of just follow him around and, you know, I'm playing hockey with him outside. And this summer is going to be some time for golf. Would love taking him just to a driving range and let him hit some balls. But that has become priority. Obviously it's just see him. And that's been a blessing too, spending the last 2 years in the AHL. Like I don't travel. I've seen him grow up since day one. You know, I've been the priority and it's been my hobby.
I could be totally off, but you bring up the fishing thing. Did you not win one of the fishing derbies out here in Vancouver when you guys went out?
No, so, well, technically, well, we came close. I think we finished second or third. The one year, the fishing derbies up in Haida Gwaii for the Autism Network.
Yeah.
Those, like, spectacular. I enjoyed it so much. It was so beautiful out there. And just the people that came with it, like you see the community, the guys that support this great cause and just spending time with them and being around them for a few days and just going out and fish together. And that was just unbelievable experience. But I remember like me and Marky, we went there together and I remember one day, like nobody was catching anything except for us. And we caught, I don't know how many fish we caught that day, but every 15 minutes, we're just reeling them in like crazy. So if it was a fishing tournament for how many catches you get, we probably would have won. But it was about the biggest salmon, biggest Chinook, biggest coho. I don't think we won any of them, but we came close, I believe, the one year.
Okay. So Marky's a fisherman too then?
I think he became one. We had a little blast together. We're just cranking tunes on a tiny boat and just enjoying ourselves and catching fish. And yeah, it's fun.
Awesome. It's awesome.
If Hollywood was to make a movie about you and your life, who would you want to play you?
Like, do I have to pick a lookalike? Because if it's a lookalike, Ryan Gosling.
No.
If I just pick based on their talent, I would say Leo Caprio.
Okay, sweet.
I mean, he's an awesome actor. I mean,
yeah, that's for sure.
I don't know if he could throw on hockey gear.
No, I wonder. I doubt he could even skate. Probably.
What would be your last meal?
Ooh, chicken nuggets.
Oh, nice. That's me.
I would just eat as many as I could until I pass out.
That's awesome. My friends give me shit all the time because we go out for a nice place and they're like, I look at the menu and I'm reading, I'm flipping it over, I'm reading. They chirp me. They're like, we all know you're getting the chicken nuggets. Just get the fucking chicken nuggets.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, but just don't even bother trying to kill me. I just kill myself eating as many nuggets as I can. Heart stops.
Yeah. If you could say one thing to Canucks Nation and the fans, what would it be?
I think that, you know, me and my family always appreciated the support. You know, I think the support was immense throughout, you know, the season where I was hurt for most of it. Like just the support I got from the fans was incredible. Just the community alone, you know, like our charity program there, the Heroes Hockey, like all those people there, like we became really close with the community, got to know so many amazing people. And yeah, I've always admired how much the Canucks do in the community and how much love there is from the fans, you know, for each player. And so always appreciated that, and that's what kept me going. And that's when I would, you know, that's one thing that, you know, that I kept in my mind. And I was hoping I was going to get a call again. I was going to play again for the Canucks, but it just wasn't meant to be.
Hey, Sven, I just want to thank you very much for taking the time for us today. And we're big fans of you, and we know that you're going to have the great rest of your career. We definitely made a mistake, and we love you as Canucks fans. Trust me.
Yeah, I appreciate that very much. Yeah, means a lot.
Yeah, we're going to be keeping our eye on you going forward, and we wish you best of the luck on whatever comes your way. But let's hope it's the NHL. And
yeah, I hope so too. I'll do whatever I can.
And Seattle's not too far down the road here.
Then we'll become rivals. Who knows?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And hey, did you have a son or a daughter, by the way?
Son. His name is Callan.
Okay, so we got another NHL player on his way.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, he loves it already, and he loves coming to the games. He really enjoys it, and he goes nuts for the Zamboni and everything. So he's already awesome. He's already breathing hockey in, and he's getting the full a full dose of it here. So he's already been on the ice a couple of times, and I sure hope so. I wouldn't wouldn't mind caddying too, you know. For
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. That would be awesome. You'd be like Wayne Gretzky with Dustin Johnson.
Exactly. So yeah, you know, if hockey's in his, it is. So we'll let him do it.
If you're looking for a mug, perhaps a hoodie, head on over to IOnlyTouchGreatness.com.
Looking for the most beers on tap, great steaks, great staff, head over to the John B. Pub.
We got the best beers, steaks, chicken wings, nachos in town. Come see us at the John B. Pub.
The John B. Pub, the best bar in town. Come sign up for our football pool. Say hey, sent you.